where it began. I can't begin to know it. Hands, touching hands, reaching out, touching me, touching you.
Good morning. I wanted to share with you today some images which might seem a little bit surprising at first, but bear with me. They're not by a Christian painter and they're not explicitly biblical in their subject matter. But nonetheless, I think they can help us to think in new and hopefully exciting ways about God, and especially about God's creation. They're painted by an artist called Juan Miro. He was a Spanish painter from the 20th century, but he painted a lot of the time in Paris. He knew the French painters of that period very well. He fits into the category of surrealism, if you wanted to categorise him. And we'll have a think about what that might mean as we look at these artworks. Now, the series I want to show you, actually, I think you need a little bit of context for, so I'm going to show you something else first. This is not something that you could see in London, although if you wanted to see some works by Miro, you could go along to Tate Modern once lockdown is over. But it's a fairly typical Miro painting. It's actually one of the first paintings that he did in what would become a very characteristic style of his. When people think of Miro, they tend to think of sort of blank backgrounds to his pictures, colour washed, colour fields, very velvety sort of texture that comes out of experimenting with the texture of the canvas and seeing what paint will do on that surface, and then overlaying it with the sort of spindly forms that you can see on the surface of that picture there. Now this is a piece from 1925. It's about 2.5 metres high. Miro's canvases often are quite large, and it's called The Birth of the World. That wasn't a title that Miro gave to it, actually. It was given to it by a curator. But he probed that title in a way. He said that it was like a genesis, or a form of new beginning. And perhaps we can start to see something of that in it, so bear with me. Miro's canvases deliberately look quite childish, and they also deliberately look quite hallucinatory. And those were two things that were very popular for the surrealists. Children, the state of infancy, was very precious to them because children weren't constrained by the thinking of adult minds. They didn't sort of think, oh, I mustn't think like that, I mustn't paint like that. They painted whatever came into their heads. And that was something that the surrealists thought was incredibly valuable in terms of finding new forms of reality, new surprising juxtapositions and images that perhaps you wouldn't think of putting onto a canvas as a grown-up. And the state of sort of imagining or hallucination was also very important to them. And when I look at a canvas like this, initially, yes, it is childish, but there are also some very delicate bits of imagery in there, the sort of spokes of a wheel, perhaps, down at the bottom left corner, and these lines that hold things together in balance across the surface. There's a red circle, there's a white circle, and I wonder if they might recall the sun and the moon, perhaps. If we were to try to tie this down as maybe being a landscape and to give it a time of day, we might say it was either dawn or dusk, those moments where you see both night and day in the sky at once. And that would also be very characteristically surrealist, images that can't be tied down to something specific, something identifiable, but that retain a sense of mystery. And so actually, as an image of the birth of the world, I find this incredibly evocative. I think there's a lot of genesis about it. It strikes me that very often artists who have tried to portray the creation of the world will portray the creation of man. And actually that seems quite small-minded in some ways. Sorry, Michelangelo. But I think Miro's conception of the birth of the world somehow seems much bigger. And if we were to think about the image of God creating the world out of nothing in Genesis, actually, this seems to match quite nicely for me. These are things that are starting to become something, but they haven't quite been tied down completely yet. God speaks, and as he speaks, things start to form, and he forms forms out of formlessness, out of nothingness, out of a void. And that seems to be what Miro is doing in a canvas like this. Psalm 19 says this, "The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech, night after night they display knowledge. There is no speech or language where their voice is not heard. Their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens he has pitched a tent for the sun, which is like a bridegroom coming forth from his pavilion, like a champion rejoicing to run his course. It rises at one end of the heavens and makes its circuit to the other. Nothing is hidden from its heat. And that's a beautiful image of the way in which God is able to pitch the skies like a tent. God is huge. God is able to bring things forth. And as God proclaims creation, speaks things into being, his creation will evermore proclaim him. The stars, every night they come out, proclaim the glory and the mystery and the awe and the wonder of God. And that leads me on to thinking about a series of much, much smaller artworks that Miro made during the Second World War. He called them the constellations. Now you might think if you were going to paint a constellation that you would paint it big. Constellations are part of the cosmic universe that's ever expanding. It's infinite, it's indefinable, it's ineffable. It should be huge. Surely it deserves that 2.5 metre canvas. But actually, these are very small. There are 23 in this series of gouache sketches. Now, gouache is a watercolour medium. It's quite portable. It comes in tubes, and you can make it very thin and create a wash in the background of a canvas, like of a composition like this. It's done on paper. Or you can make it quite thick, and you can put quite precise lines on the surface. So Miro does both of those things with that medium. But there's a reason why these are small. And that is to do with the context of their making. During the Second World War, Miro found himself in exile. He'd been living in Paris with his family. As a Spaniard, he would have liked to have gone back home to Catalonia, to Montrouge, but that was not possible in the aftermath of the Spanish Civil War. And so he and his family went first to Normandy to get out of the city, and then on to Palma de Mallorca, and eventually back home to Montrouge. So the period from 1939 to 41 for Miro was marked by uncertainty. There was no permanent studio space where you could set up an easel and a canvas. You needed works that were portable, that you could take with you. And so these are done in a portable medium. They're deliberately small so that they can be carried with him. The war does not become an excuse for Miro for not painting. He continues to paint, but he does it at the scale that he can manage during that period. Now thinking about some images that come out of war seems to be particularly apt. The 75th anniversary of VE Day will be celebrated this coming Friday. And so perhaps the experiences of that generation that went through the Second World War are at the forefront of our minds at the moment. And some of the experience of the coronavirus and lockdown has been compared, I think, for this generation to the effects of war as being one of the most devastating things that we might know. And so perhaps these can speak to our situation now. Now, the 23 gouaches often allude to things like stars. There's one called the Star of the Morning, that's here. It's not a reference to Jesus, but if we put on our biblical hats, then perhaps that's what it makes us think of. Jesus is called the Star of the Morning. But the piece that I'd really like to focus on is called The Passage of the Divine Bird. What an evocative, poetic title, and deliberately so. Miro doesn't tie down his imagery again. It's a little bit like The Birth of the World that I showed you earlier. But you can start to see shapes and forms in this picture, I think. If you think about it as a constellation, then you can start to see stars, and you can see the way that those are tied together by these spindly lines. Perhaps these are the forces of gravity that hold things together and that we try to sketch out diagrammatically when we try to understand the night sky. Perhaps they're also marking out the passage of something, the passage of time, the passage of the divine bird, whoever that is, across the sky, the passage of the sun across the sky, rising at one end of the heavens and making its circuit to the other. I don't know. Perhaps we could think about God drawing his tent across the heavens, wrapping the heavens around him like a garment. That's an image that comes from Psalm 104. Or perhaps these are the passages of individual lives that have been lived out across time. This seems a little bit like a sign language, doesn't it? When we look at the surface of this picture, we almost want to try and read it, and yet it's indecipherable, it seems somehow encrypted. Perhaps this somehow resonates for us with the language of the stars, the language of the constellations, things that seem unfathomable to us, but that somehow continually declare the glory of God. One of the images that seems to come out of these pictures by Miro very often is the image of freedom. There's one piece in the series called The Ladder of Escape.
There's another called Toward the Rainbow, perhaps an image of hope amidst that chaos of webs of lines and lives.
The piece that I've chosen is the last in the series, actually. It's from September 1941, when Miro has made it back to Montrouge with his family. But it's still a state of uncertainty, a time of not knowing what will come next. And I think that comes through in that composition. But the other thing that comes through is a sort of riot of colour. There's a sense of joyousness to these pieces, even though they're made in a state of constraint. And it strikes me that actually Miro is very good at keeping a large worldview. In a situation where his world has become so small, he can't paint on a large canvas, much like our worlds have perhaps become small and constrained at the moment, where we're stuck within our four walls very often. In that state, things could become very small-minded. We could start to think very locally, very much about ourselves. But these Miro pictures remind me to think bigger than that, to think outside of that, to think in terms of mystery and awe and wonder and the freedom that we see in the creation around us. Now, in 1958, the surrealist poet André Breton decided that he would write some short prose poems to go alongside Miro's gouaches. And in that state, they were then published as an illustrated book. If you wanted to go and see these in London, you could do so after lockdown, because there is a copy of that illustrated book in the National Art Library, which is within the Victoria and Albert Museum. It's a public library, anyone can go, you can get a reader's card as long as you've got a UK address. So you could go and you could ask to have a look at that, and you could sit and pore over it. You can't take it home, it's very valuable. But you can have a look at it in situ if you want to. But as Breton was writing those prose poems, he drew imagery out of what he saw in the pictures that he had in front of him. And one of the things that he writes next to Le passage de l'oiseau divin, the passage of the divine bird, is this. Birds and butterflies are never sad. Butterflies are very high-spirited. They play with children. They always escape, even when they are trapped and killed. Poignant words to go alongside a small gouache sketch that was made in a situation where people were being readily trapped and killed. Now, as Christians, we have hope that there is something beyond entrapment, beyond death for us, don't we? We have hope that the passage of the divine, that Jesus's life on earth, the ineffable, constrained to the small size of a human being, as a result of that, as a result of what he did for us, we can hope for freedom. We can look to the mystery of the creator of the universe, and we can say, actually, I can pinpoint that to a time and a place where that made a difference to me. The infinite becomes small in some ways, and yet asks us to expand our worldview outwards, so that we can, as Isaiah chapter 40 tells us, soar on wings like eagles. Perhaps that's one of the images that comes to my mind when I think of the divine bird, whatever that might be, cutting across that gouache picture that we have looked at together. So I think I take these as an encouragement in our constrained situations to think big, to look for the mystery and the awe and the wonder of God in the world around us, however small that world might seem at the moment. Amen.